Proverbs 22 and 4. The reward of humility, that is, having a realistic view of one's importance and the reverent, worshipful fear of the Lord, is riches, honor, and life. So this is where I'm kind of going today. Humility, right? That's the first thing it says, humility. That is the fear of the Lord, right? And then it comes with a great promise if you continue reading it. Like, what a promise. What else could we desire that is not contained in this promise, right? He is promising honor, right, which means the highest respect, great esteem. Another word for honor is glory and privilege, right? He's promising riches. He will give you everything you need and then some. And we can't just look at that in the natural, right? He's not just going to give you everything you need in the natural. It's more about the spiritual, right? And he's going to give you life to the fullest, lacking nothing. So if we break this down, there are two keys to this scripture. First is humility, and second is fear of the Lord. And then, like I said earlier, we need to really understand what the fear of the Lord is, right? We need to know God's nature and his purpose and also his authority. Let's see. So to fear the Lord, you need to love God and have a deep respect for him. So I've kind of thought about that a little bit in the natural aspect of my short time on this planet, right? And it's fear of the Lord. And I've like, you know what? I've kind of like, in the natural, I've had the same fear for those that have been put in authority over me in my life, like my dad, for instance. It's not that I was afraid of my dad, but I was afraid to let him down, afraid to do something wrong, you know, afraid not to meet his standard, right? And it kind of just continued on in my life, like even at work. I'm not afraid of my boss, right? But I am afraid to let them down. I am afraid to not meet their standard. And it's the same with us in this walk with God, is we need to, you know, it's not to be afraid of God, but it's just afraid to not meet his stand, not to meet his expectations, right? Excuse me? Right, exactly. And that is the fear of the Lord. But you need to be humble in that aspect, though. There's just such humility that comes with that, because you need to just, like, I'm going to get into it, but you just need to, it's almost like a bending of the knee when it comes to humility. You know what I'm saying? So I'm going to get to that. I'm going to stop talking, because I'm going to jack this whole thing up if I start talking and not going along with what I have here. But we need to take this walk seriously, right, and obey what he says. He keeps his promises. That is the key, right? He just promised all these things as long as you did what? As long as you bend your knee, right? He promises all these things. And last time I checked, God doesn't break a promise, right? Yeah. Yep. So I'm going to go into James 4. James 4:10. Humble yourselves with an attitude of repentance and insignificance in the presence of the Lord, and he will exalt you. He will lift you up, and he will give you purpose. I know we sing that song sometimes. I can't remember all the words, but what is it? Humble thyself in the sight of the Lord. And what is he going to do? He will lift you up what? Higher and higher and higher. What are we always talking about? Come up higher. How are you going to get there? Bend your knee. Humble yourself, right? Know that you need him. Right. Know that you need him no matter what circumstance you're in. That is my problem. I don't always think I need him, because I know I can do it on my own in the natural, right? But I do need him. We need him all the time, right? Let's see. So, definition of humility. Let's see. Humility as freedom from pride or arrogance, the quality or state of being humble. For further depth into this step, oh, sorry, I shouldn't have read that. That's what I just typed in there. Copy that in there. So there's three senses that actually bring this into a further depth. So it's not proud or haughty. It's not arrogance or assertive. Reflecting expressing or offered in a spirit of deference or submission, a humble apology, ranking low in a hierarchy or scale, not costly or luxurious. So the word humility is in the Bible often, right? It's in there a lot. If you went to, I didn't actually look to see how many times it is, but it's in there a lot. But it's often characterized as genuine gratitude and a lack of arrogance, a modest view of oneself. Humility is a critical and continuous emphasis of godliness in the Bible. We are called upon to be humble followers of Christ and trust in the wisdom and salvation of God. Right? So true humility is to see ourselves as we actually are, right? Fallen in sin and helpless without God. Think about the first time God touched your heart, right? I was thinking about that this morning. You know, like just the experience of it, it was literally like, you know, it changed your life. Like, you know, that first time, when you first got saved, when you first realized who he really was, it was very humbling. You know I cried. It brought me down, and I said, thank you, Lord. Like, oh, my God, you know, and that's what it is right there. That's true humility, is knowing that, right, exactly, yep. Let's see. So the importance of humility is directly related to the deadly consequences of pride, right? So pride is what separates us from God, as we do not acknowledge and appreciate the eternal sovereignty of our Lord, right? That's what I just talked about. I think I don't need him, even though I do, right? Or I only call out to him when I actually do need him. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So therefore, the importance of humility is seen in the deep gratitude we hold in proper recognition of God's divinity and love for us. Humility's importance is also found in recognizing our flawed nature, right, as humans on this earth, susceptibility to sin, if not vigilant against temptation. So our humility's importance, like, we just need to recognize that we are not perfect. You know, and that's the issue. Like, sometimes we walk around acting like we are, yeah, right? And that's when the pride comes in, right? I don't have any issues. I'm good, God. Yeah. Go talk to that person over there. I saw them, you know, watching something they weren't supposed to be watching. They were talking about something they weren't supposed to talk about. Go deal with them. I'm good, God. All set. You know, I don't need you to correct me today. Let's see. Proverbs 3:5. Trust in and rely confidently, right? Trust in and rely confidently on the Lord with all your heart, and do not rely on your own insight or understanding. I do this one backwards all the time, right? I try to rely on my own insight and my own understanding, because like I just said, I think I have it all figured out. You know, I know it all. I'm perfect, but I'm not, right? But trust in him and rely confidently on the Lord with all your heart. Not with a little bit of your heart, all your heart. And the issue is like, to be humble, we have to have faith, right? You got to believe, right? To be humble, you got to believe that God is going to lead us into the best way to live and how to avoid the temptation of this world, right? We've got to believe it. You've got to have that faith to be humble. We've got to put our complete trust in the Lord and not deceive ourselves with vanity or lust. There's so much deception out there, you know, so much vanity, so much lust out there. It's running wild, right? Yeah, there's temptation everywhere you look, you know? See, we need to lean on the understanding, wisdom, and divinity of God to show us the righteous path through prayer and fasting. Let's see. So in order to do this, we must have the initial requirement of humility to open our hearts and withdraw from arrogance of our ego, right? Our ego, it's kind of like your pride, essentially. Another word for pride is ego, right? You need to withdraw from your own arrogance of our ego. Let's see. In 1 Peter 5:6, to enter God's presence, we must come what? Humbly to the throne, right? Matthew 5:5 said, says, God says the meek shall inherit the earth. James 4 and 10, which I'm going to get deeper into, but the proud are cast down and will be humbled. 2 Timothy 2:12, when we are humbled or even when we suffer, we need to remember we will ultimately reign with Christ. And here's the key, right? This is the key one. Philippians 2:5. Jesus even humbled himself, right? Even humbled himself from where he was to walk this life out, to the death, till it was finished. He humbled himself, right? Think about that. So therefore, we should also have the mind of humility. I'm not trying to be hard with this lesson today. I'm just trying to be real. I'm always trying to be real with what I share. I'm not trying to make it harder, deeper, you know, like I don't have the ruler out today. But this is what builds character, right? It's gonna hurt a little bit to build character. Let's see. So humility in the Bible, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourself, not looking to your own interest, but each of you to the interest of others. Right? We all know that. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equally with God something to be used to his own advantage, right? He could have used that to his own advantage when he was on this earth, but he didn't. Rather, he made himself nothing, right? By taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself even to the death, like I just said. So humility is essential for establishing a right relationship with God and other people. You know, it's also necessary for maintaining a proper perception of ourselves, right? Humility is a character trait that greatly pleases God. It does. That's why it's in the Bible so many times. Humility is the appropriate posture people ought to have with God. When we maintain a humble attitude, right? This is what I just talked about a little while ago. When we maintain a humble attitude, we reveal our dependence on Him, right? That's why it's either you're going to be humble or you're going to have pride, right? You either need Him or you don't. And we need Him all the time, don't we? Or we just shut Him off like that light switch. I don't need you right now. A little too bright for me, God.
Turn the light off, right?
So the Hebrew word for humility carries the idea of crouching down, bowing low to the ground, or being afflicted. So there's several terms in the Greek language convey the concept of humility. There's submissiveness, there's meekness, abasement, modesty of character, lowliness of spirit, neediness, and smallness. There are several Hebrew words that can be translated as humble or humility. This one comes from the root anav, which denotes a condition of character depending on God due to internal spiritual orientation, right? It's all about the internal, the spiritual orientation, rather than what? The external, right? The root of this word also indicates that relying on God is a choice, right? We have a choice if we're going to rely on Him or not, right? But it's not because you physically have to, right? So He gives us the choice. You know, he gives you the choice to rely on Him or not. You can either say yes or no, right? In Deuteronomy 8:2, Moses tells the Israelites that God led them through the wilderness and cared for them for 40 years. Why? To humble you, right? And to test you, to know what was in your heart, right? Whether you would keep His commandments. So I'm going to jump into James, Brother James 4, starting at verse 6. But He gives us more and more grace through the power of the Holy Spirit to defy sin and live an obedient life that reflects both our faith and our gratitude for our salvation.
Therefore, it says, God is opposed to the proud and haughty. Interesting. He's opposed to the proud and the haughty. Do you want God opposing you? I wouldn't want to oppose God, right? But, right, there's a but. There's that but word. But continually gives the gift of grace to the humble, right, who turn away from self-righteousness. So submit to the authority of God, right? Resist the devil, stand firm against him, and he will flee from you. For verse 8, come close to God with a contrite heart, and he will come close to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your unfaithful hearts, you double-minded people. Be miserable and grieve and weep over your sin. That's funny. I mean, just like, be miserable and grieve and weep over your sin. Like, I don't know why I just said that, but I thought that was funny. Like, he wants you to be miserable and grieve over the things you've done. Like, repent. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I just thought that was, I just got a little chuckle out of that, sorry. I don't know why. Oh, gosh. Oh, yeah, I know why, because the next verse says, let your foolish laughter be turned to mourning and your reckless joy to the gloom. That explains why I just said that. See? Verse 10. I'm trying to wake you guys up. Humble yourselves with an attitude of repentance and insignificance, right, in the presence of the Lord, and he will exalt you. He will lift you up. He will give you purpose. So there's the song we just talked about, right? Humble yourself in the presence of the Lord, right? And he will exalt you. He will lift you up. He will bring you higher and higher. Give you confidence, right? Yep. 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 So that actually, what I just read, right? There is actually 10 commands in there, right? Each one is so stated in Greek that it calls for immediate action in rooting out the sinful attitude of pride, right? It's resist the devil was the first one. Wash your hands, right? Before we know this, in the Old Testament, priests ministered to God in the tabernacle. They had to wash their hands and feet, right, as a symbol of spiritual cleansing, right? So clean hands, pure heart, right? Then it says grieve, mourn, wail, repent, right? It's all right there. Proverbs 11:2. When pride comes, boiling up with an arrogant attitude of self-importance, then come dishonor and shame. But with the humble, this says, and this is tying in exactly what I've been talking about, but with the humble, the teachable, who have been chiseled by trial, who have learned to walk humbly with God, there is wisdom and soundness of mind. Right? The teachable who have been chiseled by trial. Right? Think of that, chiseling something away. Right? You get through that trial, chisel it off. Keep moving on. Slowly shaped, right? Like that pot on that wheel. Slowly shaped and formed, right? 2 Chronicles 7:14. And my people who are called by my name, humble themselves and pray and seek. Right? First thing is humble, though. You got to humble yourself first. Pray and seek. Pray, crave, right? Crave. That's what the Amplified says. Crave. That is, it says require as a necessity, right? You need to crave him, seek him, crave him. Well, like when you ever like crave something, yep. Sister Burn, I know you had that reaction, like you're always craving something, but you ever crave like some sort of chocolate or ice cream at night? You'll do whatever you can. Like we'll go through ice, like when at home, if somebody's craving chocolate, these guys will tear the house apart.
Your wife gets the microphone.
I didn't say her name though, but they will tear the house apart. They even, yeah, but no joke, one time they stole the chocolate chips because they, it might have been me, but like we stole the chocolate chips, but that's how much you need to crave him though. You know, you need to just do whatever it takes to satisfy that craving, right? Whatever it takes, right? See, I had to throw myself under the bus about stealing chocolate chips. The white ones are the good ones too. The white ones are the good ones. Oh, God. Okay. John 3:30. We must increase, right, in prominence, but I must decrease, right? We've talked about this a lot. To attain more of him, you will have to lose more of yourself. To pick something up, you're going to have to put something down. You know, we've talked about that numerous times here. To get more of him, you're going to have to lose more of yourself.
stop craving those sweet things in the middle of the night. Let's see, Psalm 111, 110. Just going to read through it, 1 through 10. Praise the Lord, hallelujah. I will give thanks to the Lord with all my heart, right? He wants to be praised with a whole heart, in the company of the upright and in the congregation. The company of the upright, those are those who you are really close-knitted to. Great are the works of the Lord. Great are those things he has done for us, studied by all those who delight in them. Splendid and majestic is his work, and his righteousness endures forever. He has made his wonderful acts to be remembered. Remembered when you remember something, you always talk about it, right? So like, he has made his wonderful acts to be remembered, right? So everything he has done, like I was actually thinking about that the other day. I'm like, wow, everything he has done in my life, I can actually remember. Like I got this issue where I forget things, but a lot of it's in the natural. But I think back and I think of what he has done. And I'm like, wow, I can't forget what he has done, because why? Everything he has done has been so wonderful that I just can't forget it, right? If you think of it that way. And then when you remember it, what do? You're always talking about it, yep. Right? You're always spreading that to somebody next to you and letting them know what he has done, right? Yes. But he's designed it this way, right? He does things so we remember, so we can proclaim the good things that he has done, right? The Lord is gracious and merciful and full of loving compassion. He has given food to those who fear him with awe-inspired reverence. You know, he gives provision to those who fear him. He'll take care of you, right? He will remember his covenant forever. Unlike man, God never forgets a promise that he makes, right? He has declared and made known to his people the power of his works in giving them the heritage of the nation. God hides nothing, right? When you declare something, you make it known to everyone, right? He doesn't hide anything, right? He makes everything known. Because there's nothing, like, normally if you're going to hide something, it's usually something bad. There is no bad in God, so he doesn't have to hide nothing, right? The works of his hands are truth and absolute justice, right? Everything God does is true and fair. All his precepts are sure, established, reliable, and trustworthy. They are upheld forever and ever. They are done in absolute truth and uprighteousness. He has sent redemption to his people. He has ordained his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name, inspiring reverence and godly fear, right? So we're back to the fear word. He has rescued us from our oppression and our sin, right? The reverent fear of the Lord is the beginning, the prerequisite, the absolute essential, the alphabet of wisdom, right? A good understanding and a teachable heart are possessed by all those who do the will of the Lord. His praise endures forever. Let's see. So this ties into Psalm 112. So I'm going to continue to Psalm 112. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Blessed, fortunate, prosperous, and favored by God. Right? Is the man who fears the Lord with awe-inspired reverence and worships him with obedience, who delights greatly in his commandments, who truly loves his word. Right? His descendants will be mighty on the earth. The generation of the upright will be blessed. Wealth and riches are in his house, and his righteousness endures forever. Wealth and riches, right? Wealth, the natural, and riches, the spirit. God will bless you in both aspects, right? Light arises in the darkness for the upright. He is gracious and compassionate and righteous. The one who fears the Lord will be blessed with his light in this darkness-filled world. It is well with the man who is gracious and lends. He conducts his affairs with justice. He will never be shaken, right? He will never be shaken. You will be firmly established. Your foundation will be built upon him. The righteous will be remembered forever. Your good deeds will never be forgotten, right? He will not fear bad news. His heart is steadfast, trusting, confidently relying on and believing in the Lord. So no matter what the circumstance, you won't be afraid, right? That's what it's saying. His heart is upheld, King James Version uses the word established, right, which means to prop up, to lean upon, take hold of, or bear up. He will not fear while he looks with satisfaction on his adversaries. He has given freely to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. So like the profile of this man or woman who fears the Lord is remarkable, right? It's a reflection of the character of God himself, right? It's kind of like if you think about like how the moon reflects the sun, it's essentially kind of like the same thing. It is partially fulfilled in the godly man or woman and perfectly fulfilled, right? It's partially fulfilled without him, but you're only going to perfectly fulfill it with him, right? Let's see. He's also a God-fearing man who fears the Lord. He is a lover of God's word. He delights greatly in his commandments. He is a man that makes home for his family, you know, his descendants, his house. He is a loving and kind man, gracious and full of compassion. He is a helping man who deals graciously and lends. He is a wise man who guides his affairs with discretion. He is a strong man, not afraid of evil tidings. He is a generous man. He has dispersed abroad. He is a man who does not abuse power. His horn will exalt with honor. He is a hated man. The wicked will see it and be grieved. His horn will be exalted in honor. The wicked will see it and be angered. He will gnash his teeth and melt away in despair and death. The desire of the wicked will perish and come to nothing. So what am I saying, right? My whole point of this today is like, we need to humble ourselves, right? And we need to, like, I was putting this together and I was listening to some music. Don't always listen to music when I do it because it distracts me, but oh yeah, Kayla's gonna play a song in a second. So like, I heard this song when I was playing this and I was like, wow, this is so perfect, right? Because when you humble yourself, right? When humility comes, you give up control. You give it all to him, right? You have nothing to do with what is happening, right? Because you trust him, right? So we're gonna end this and Kayla's gonna play a song real quick. Oh, the word's gonna be up there? I don't know if they're gonna play a video. Let's see. I don't know if you can see the words, but there's going to be lyrics with it too, but I thought it was really good. I have the lyrics, so I can just read the lyrics if you want.
No, I just need to find the mouse over there.
The mouse. Good? All good things come to those who wait. Okay, just wanted to let you know. Yes. I'll just read it. It's fine. It's good. No, no, I can't do that. All right. So the title of the song is "It's Control," right? It's for King and Country. Sage can probably sing it for you. So when they're done, I'll ask her to come up here. But the lyrics are very simple. You asked me to let go, but I thought I knew better. Right? My pride got in the way. I thought I knew better. Oh. There's words coming.
You asked me to let go,
right? So humility, give up control, right, to him, everything, everything, every aspect. Even today during worship, give up control, be humble, bow your knee, right? Amen. Right? Amen. Thank you, Lord.